Hello everyone, welcome back to Altium Academy. I'm your host, Zach Peterson, and today we are going to be talking about surface finishes on a PCB, how they affect signal integrity, and how they impact assembly and reliability. Now, I recently received in my email a question about surface finishes, and it made me realize we've never really done this topic justice. So that's exactly what we're going to look at today. Let's go ahead and get started. So before we jump into talking about PCB surface finishes, let's take a look at this viewer question. Superfan Jim Jewett writes, could you do a video on what surface finishes and conformal coating actually help with? For example, there are lots of web pages listing the various surface finishes, and a few discuss shelf life, price, and solderability. But there seems to be disagreement, sometimes even within the same page, over how long the shelf life is, and I've yet to see a definition of what it actually means. Except perhaps for this comment on PCB Way, that products beyond their shelf life will only affect soldering with no other adverse effects. So from this discussion, Jim has three questions. Let's take a quick look. Number one, is any surface finish needed if the fabricator is also the assembler? Number two, after the parts are soldered on, does the surface finish still help prevent tarnishing on the pads and other features? Number three, why does OSP seem to be in a totally different category than all other surface finishes? Great questions, Jim, and I want to dive into all three of those questions. But first, I think we should look at, very briefly, what actually happens chemically when you solder something onto a board. Let's take a look. Soldering results in the growth of compounds called intermetallics. Intermetallics are basically an alloy between two different species of metals, and they can be stoichiometric or non-stoichiometric. For example, the intermetallic that most commonly forms between copper and tin is Cu6SN5. Intermetallics are necessary because they are what give the solder joint its strength. However, those intermetallics can grow in size and cause depletion of other metal species from around the intermetallic film, and that can result in lower strength and eventual fracture of the solder joint. To see what the intermetallic film actually looks like, let's take a look at this paper from STI Electronics. Here in this paper, the company has provided some microscope images looking at the growth of intermetallic film directly onto a component lead that's being soldered onto a printed circuit board. If I actually zoom into this microscope image, you can see the fiber weave bundle in the printed circuit board substrate. Then we have the copper pad. Here we have the lead for the component, and then here they're pointing out the intermetallic formation region between the solder and the tinning on the component lead. This film growth results from diffusion of metal species into the growing intermetallic film that then forms this stoichiometric compound, SNCU, as you see here on screen. If we get insufficient diffusion, you can see things like voiding, as shown here in this image. Here, this voiding results in fractures at the microscopic level, as we can see here by the voids between the CuSn intermetallic and the bulk solder. In addition to determining the intermetallic growth that forms a solder joint, surface platings on copper also affect signal integrity for signals traveling on your interconnects. Let's take a quick look at how signal integrity is affected by different types of plating. Here on screen, I have a slide from my recent presentation at PCB East 2024, and this particular slide looks at the effects of different surface platings on insertion loss in the same type of interconnect. So all of these insertion loss curves on the right are for the same geometry transmission line, and you can see very clearly that different surface platings create different levels of loss once you get to high enough frequency. Now, at low enough frequency, of course, you're probably not going to notice much of a difference, but once you get into the 10 or 20 gigahertz range, you start to see a very significant difference in the insertion loss. The bottom two curves for ENIG and ENEPIG are nickel-containing surface platings, and those surface platings have a bit of additional roughness due to the interface between nickel and gold, and they incur additional loss due to the fact that nickel is ferromagnetic, so it has some additional magnetic loss. Up at the top of this graph, we have some overlapping blue curves for copper, OSP, and immersion silver. You can see here that basically OSP and immersion silver have comparable loss to bare copper. In the middle, we have a typical solder mask curve, and then we also have immersion tin as kind of a mid-range loss plating. If you want to learn more about surface finishes and how they affect high-speed signal propagation, take a look at the IEEE article linked in the description. Now I think we're ready to answer Jim's first question. If the fabricator is also the assembler and will be sending finished boards, is any surface finish actually needed? Well, the answer here is yes, a surface finish is still needed. If you're soldering with, let's say, tin solder onto a copper pad, you are going to form a copper tin intermetallic, most commonly Cu6SN5. This intermetallic can oxidize and become more brittle over time. Let's take a look just very briefly at this webpage on copper.org. I didn't even know copper.org was a thing. But there you go. Here you can see they have a page specifically dedicated to copper tin intermetallic compounds. Now, copper tin intermetallics are already hard and brittle, and at the surface, they do easily oxidize. That oxidized intermetallic can adversely affect the contact resistance and the solderability. And you can see here, as you look down the page, the mechanism by which that occurs. Here on the very top in the bulk tin solder, you have tin species, which eventually diffuses into the copper tin intermetallics. Those intermetallics grow, and then you have a copper tin surface that eventually oxidizes, becomes less wettable, becomes harder to rework, and I think also becomes more brittle. I think now we can also answer Jim's second question. Question two, after the parts are soldered on, does the surface finish still help prevent tarnish on the pads, leads, test pads via annular rings? If not, is there something else that should be done, either for electrical function or for aesthetics? Well, the answer is yes, it can still continue to oxidize. We saw that from the recent example from copper.org, but you can also see that in cases where a surface plating is applied, such as, for example, with a silver-plated PCB. Let's jump onto the microscope and look at one of my older boards, and you'll really be able to see the tarnishing on the surface of these PCBs. Here on screen, I have a test board that has a silver surface finish applied, and as you can see here looking at some of the pads, it is quite clear that we do have some tarnishing. You can see some tarnishing here that gets pretty severe right around the edge of these SMD pads. If I just keep going over here, eventually you can see some other areas where the tarnishing gets pretty severe, such as this pad up here in the corner. Here you can see some pretty severe tarnishing, and this wouldn't normally be visible because this is part of a land grid array. However, in general, with SMD pads, you're not coating the entire pad with solder. There is going to be some left over exposed pad, and that portion of the pad can continue to tarnish, especially when it is coated with silver. Now, silver is a bit unique because it normally tarnishes through exposure to oxygen, as well as exposure to sulfur-containing gases. And that's what creates this very particular hue on this surface finish. However, other surface finishes will oxidize as well. And the level of oxidation varies by the chemistry of the surface that is exposed to oxygen and humidity. The exact level of environmental exposure also determines the level of oxidation, as well as the rate of oxidation that you would observe on the surface. Now, even though we haven't done a video about surface finishes, oxidation, or tarnishing on this channel, we have actually done a podcast on it. We recently had expert on PCB surface finishes and plating, Kunal Shah, on the podcast to discuss some of these issues. Let's see what he has to say about long-term reliability in the face of oxidation and tarnishing.
The number one concern I see brought up about silver is just the corrosion with tarnishing.
So that is something at the time of assembly.
Sure.
So I think it is very, very critical because, you know, it is referred as a 6 months shelf life. But when you are in a, you know, 4 or 5 months range, you start to see tarnishing of silver, and that actually affects your assembly process. So that is sort of an early stage issue with the tarnishing. And then the dendrite is sort of after assembly, an application stage issue with dendrites. So sort of from a both perspective, corrosion before assembly and corrosion and dendrite after in the application after assembly is something that one has to keep in mind in terms of immersion silver.
I think an important takeaway from this discussion about exposure to oxygen and moisture and tarnishing is this. As long as you get the soldering done before any of that long-term oxidation accrues in your PCB, you're going to be able to ensure that your solder joints have long lifetime and good reliability. Next, let's look at Jim's third question. Why does OSP seem to be a different category than anything else that's called a surface finish? To answer this question, I think we need to first review what exactly is an OSP surface finish. OSP stands for Organic Solderability Preservative. It is an organic-based film that is applied to copper pads on the surface layer of a PCB in order to provide a wettable surface for solder. Because this is an organic film, it can be dissolved or degraded by exposure to moisture or exposure to solvents such as alcohols. It can also be degraded by flux. And in fact, you do need to use flux to strip the solderability preserve from the copper when soldering directly onto those copper pads. Also, because OSP is an organic thin film, it can be degraded by exposure to UV light. Proper hermetic sealing and storage in a cool, dark place is going to be good enough to ensure that your PCBs have maximum lifetime before soldering. When is OSP an ideal choice for surface finish for your PCB? Well, as we saw in the earlier insertion loss plots, when you need low insertion loss at very high frequencies, you might consider using OSP as your surface finish. Also, it's a low cost option, and if you know that you're not gonna have to wait very long between finish of fabrication and beginning of assembly, you could use OSP. It does have a lower shelf life, but of course, if you're not storing these on the shelf for very long, the shelf life is less important. Other advantages of OSP include compatibility with double-sided reflow soldering. There is no lead and there's no tin, so you don't have any problems with whiskering. And it is known to be easier to rework by SMT technicians. Our podcast guest, Kunal Shah, also made some great points about OSP. Let's take a look at what he has to say.
If you are not able to, you know, like immersion tin or OSP or some of the other hassle, you're looking at a shelf life 3 months, 6 months, you know, roundabout in that range. However, when ENIG got introduced, you could have anywhere from 12 to 24 months shelf life. So it gave you a much more freedom in terms of doing assembly and bare board manufacturing, sort of, you know, in terms of the planning out how you're going to do logistics. However, as we are moving into UHDI, when you have ENIG, and that's what I'm going to be actually focusing on in the present in our session in on March 26th, which is the part of SMTA, on focusing on UHDI, because what happens is some of these copper is not traditional copper plating. It's using some sort of SAP, semi-additive process, or MSAP processes, as you may have heard. So what happens that it actually puts some sort of a palladium ink or palladium layer wherever you want these feature to populate.
In summary, selection of a PCB surface plating is an important engineering decision just like any other, and it requires balancing several constraints. For example, if reliability is a big issue and you don't care about insertion loss, you might choose an alternative to OSP. However, if you're looking for a low-cost option, you might consider immersion tin or OSP. There are several different factors to consider here, and I think we've only really scratched the surface, especially when we look at reliability. When it comes to reliability, one of the important factors is where your board is going to operate and what it might be exposed to during its lifetime. That will definitely influence the surface plating selection, because that will, of course, influence the degradation mechanism that ultimately limits the lifetime of your product. Thank you very much, Jim, for sending that list of questions. I had a lot of fun making this video, and I hope you all had fun watching it. If you have any questions, of course, leave your comments and questions in the comments section. Make sure to hit that subscribe button, hit that like button, and as always, don't forget to call your fabricator, folks. We'll see you next time.